Our final speaker will be Professor Pantelis Kalaitzidis, who is director of the Volos Academy for Theological Studies, which is now certainly the most dynamic theological institution in Greece. Dr. Kalaitzidis also teaches theology at the Hellenic Open University and the St. Sergius Institute of Orthodox Theology in Paris. He studied theology in Thessaloniki and ancient and medieval philosophy at the Sorbonne. His doctoral thesis deals with the issue of Greekness and anti-Westernism in the Greek theology of the 1960s, especially in Christos Yenaras. He has published or edited a number of books in Greek, including The Church and Eschatology, Gender and Religion, The Role of Women in the Church, Orthodoxy and Modernity, Turmoil in Postwar Theology, The Greek Theology of the 60s, and Orthodoxy and Hellenism in Contemporary Greece. He is also the author of Orthodoxy and Political Theology in English, which is the subject of our seminar this today. His main research, speaking, and teaching interests revolve precisely around Orthodoxy and Modernity, including multiculturalism, literature, religious nationalism, fundamentalism, and ecumenism. Dr. Kalaitzidis will speak on Orthodox political theology between communitarianism and community. Pantelis.
Thank you, Paul, for your introduction. Thank you to the organizers for this invitation, and thank you to all of you for coming here. I will try to speak actually on Orthodox political theology between person, community, and communitarianism. And I will use as example, as case study, the famous marching of Archbishop Iakovos alongside with Dr. Martin Luther King in Selma, Alabama, for the civic rights movement and equality movement. So, a pervasive reserve, not to say rejection, seems to characterize the attitude of many Orthodox hierarchs, thinkers, and theologians towards human rights. Indeed, to such a degree that there is now a firm conviction in Western circles that Orthodoxy is incompatible with the modern world and the achievements of modernity, with democracy, human rights, and political liberalism. The Council of Human Rights does indeed seem to form a challenge to which historical and contemporary Orthodoxy, and indeed Orthodox theology itself, have not always been able to respond positively. At the same time, Orthodox theology has frequently sought to defend this deficiency or to invest it with theological and philosophical meaning. At the basis of the philosophy of rights, a sizable trend in Orthodox theology perceives nothing more than the idolization of individualism and the glorification of the individual, which it contrasts with the supposedly communitarian culture of Orthodoxy. This kind of theology seems nothing more than a rebellion against the divine order and its substitution by a purely humanist order on earth, in all resulting in the fragmentation of communitarian life. Indeed, prominent Orthodox theologians with significant influence in Greece and the wider Orthodox world, such as the Greek theologian and philosopher Christos Yenaras, go so far as to talk about the, quotation mark, inhumanity of rights, about a logic of rights according to which the claims of the individual became so central and there is the threat of altering our anthropology and lapsing into a form of human psychology that is deficient in relationality and communication. The Orthodox detractors of the rights language argue that the whole paradigm of modernity was grounded on an egocentric perspective, inherently linked with a non-relational, autonomous, individualistic understanding of the human person. These and other similar Orthodox arguments for rightly denouncing human rights, appear to do justice to the critical voices formulated of those Western intellectuals or scholars, such as political scientist Samuel Huntington or psychoanalyst Julia Kristeva, who maintain that in the Orthodox tradition, the individual is doomed to remain underdeveloped. This because the very structure of Eastern Christianity is hopelessly collectivist and subordinates the individual to collectivities such as the nation or the community, while Orthodox societies as a whole are incompatible with pluralism, democracy, and human rights. The same time of Orthodox negativism towards human rights gives often the impression of a philosophical and cultural affinity between Orthodoxy and Islam, contributing to an image of an anti-Western Orthodoxy far from the European standards. What ultimately seems therefore problematic for numerous Orthodox hierarchs and church intellectuals is the preeminence of individuality implied in human rights, which contradict the communal or even communitarian character of Orthodox church and tradition. These scholars would have not a problem with what we would call communal rights or even cultural rights, but still remain very reluctant to accept and to integrate in their thought human rights because the latter are connected to and defined by individualism. And yes, the individual rights of the individualistic secularized West, they oppose the communal rights of the Orthodox communitarian East. At end of the day, however, how incompatible is Orthodoxy and its ecclesial vision with the rights of the subject and even with individuality? And how communitarian is the ecclesial ethos and theological self-understanding of Eastern Orthodoxy? And why should we be forced to consider as self-evident the identification between communal and communitarian? In the remaining part of my presentation, I will attempt to offer some initial answers and evidences to these crucial questions, starting with the example of the late Archbishop Iacobos of America and his engagement along with Dr. Martin Luther King for civic rights and equality. So the first part of my presentation is about Iacobos and this famous cover from Life. On March 26, in 1965, the Life magazine featured a cover photo with the Greek Orthodox Archbishop Iacobos marching along with Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in Selma, Alabama, for equality rights, as King holds a wreath for Reverend James Reed's memorial service. The latter, a white American Unitarian Universalist minister, was brutally clubbed to death on March 11, 1965 in Selma by segregationists while marching for civil rights. During the memorial service, Archbishop Iacobos spoke briefly about the meaning of Reeb's death in the following terms, and I quote here Iacobos, Archbishop Iacobos: "I came to this memorial service because I believe this is an appropriate occasion not only to dedicate myself as well as our Greek Orthodox communicants to the noble cause for which our friend, the Reverend James Reeb, gave his life, but also in order to show our willingness to continue this fight against prejudice, bias, and persecution. In this God-given cause, I feel sure that I have the full and understanding support of our Greek Orthodox faithful of America. For our Greek Orthodox Church and our people fully understand from our heritage and our tradition such sacrificial involvements. Our church has never hesitated to fight when it felt it must for the rights of mankind. And many of our churchmen have been in the forefront of these battles time and again." End of the quotation. In those years, such a gesture was not something easy for a white religious leader of immigrant background to stand on the side of Martin Luther King and to demonstrate next to him in the south of America for the equal civil rights of the Afro-Americans. Today, such a move might be easier, but at that time, it was really something very risky, for which not only courage and determination was required, but also a clear decision to go against his own family and relatives, if needed, and even against his own spiritual family and religious community. As characteristically noted by Coretta Scott King, King's widow, highlighting the importance of Archbishop Iacobo's support, and here I quote Coretta Scott King, "At a time when many of the nation's most prominent clergy were silent, Archbishop Iacobo courageously supported our freedom movement and marched alongside my husband, and he continued to support the non-violent movement against poverty, racism, and violence throughout his life." End of the quotation. However, as I'm going to remind you in this paper, Archbishop Iacobo, by marching arm in arm with King for equality and civil rights, he was confronted with the Greek Orthodox community by lacking its support in this public act. In the contrary, he took a difficult personal decision despite or even against the negative opinion of the Greek Orthodox clergy and community. That is the reason maybe why the Archbishop felt the need to say in his public talk I mentioned before that, and I quote again, quotation mark, "in this God-given cause I feel sure that I have the full and understanding support of our Greek Orthodox faithful of America. For our Greek Orthodox Church and our people fully understand from our heritage and our tradition such sacrificial involvement." End of the quotation. Trying by this assertion to assure first himself and then the people present in the memorial service for his own religious community support. We know today that this was not true, and that for his self-marching, he himself faced a strong opposition and critique from his clergy and community too. As noted by George Poulos in his biography of Iacobos, and I quote here Poulos, "some Southern Orthodox took offense at this picture of their archbishop fraternizing with civil rights agitators." End of the quotation. Years later, the retired Archbishop Iacobos told King biographer Taylor Brandt that he had decided to go to Selma, and I quote again, "against the advice of his clergy and staff, who worried correctly that he would be called traitor to the quest of marginalized Greeks for full acceptance as Americans." Not a single member of the Orthodox community, he reported, appeared for scheduled events at this next stop, and he found himself alone in a Charleston hotel room, telling hostile callers nationwide that he was compelled to Selma by formative memories of Greek suffering on his native island of Imbros under harsh occupation by the Ottoman Turks. End of the quotation. If I'm speaking of Archbishop Iacobos marching in Selma and his solidarity with Martin Luther King and the civic rights movement, it is because I believe that this story is of high importance for a paper dealing with Orthodox political theology between person, community, and communitarianism, and its relevance for Orthodoxy and human rights debate. As Orthodox Afro-American scholar and eminent specialist of slave religion Albert Raboteau for Princeton University noted from his side, commenting on the civic rights movement and the involvement of these of religious figures, and here I quote Raboteau, "that movement has served as a paradigm of religious activism for social justice in the public square, the arena, as Iacobos called it, alluding to those ancient arenas where martyrs died for the faith. Though many saw it as merely political, King and those who agreed with his vision interpreted the movement as a moral struggle, a God-given cause, as Archbishop Iacobos put it, to achieve social justice for those denied human dignity and equality. As much as his words, the Archbishop's presence at Selma was, as his critiques perceived, a powerful symbol of an Orthodox commitment to social justice. End of the quotation. I would add that Archbishop's presence at Selma saved the honor and dignity not only of Orthodoxy, but even of the historic and traditional Christian churches, the vast majority of which remained silent or absent during the dramatic events that took place in Alabama and the civic rights and equality movement. Greek American people and community are today proud of this high symbolic act of Archbishop Iakovos, but at that time they were critical to him, blaming their spiritual leader for fraternizing with the marginalized Afro-Americans. What I'm trying to say by using this example is that the very concept of personhood, or even the often neglected individual, and not only community, is also very important for Orthodox spiritual life, as well as for Orthodox political theology. This attempt is of particular interest for the Orthodox and human rights debate, and especially for the usual divide between individual versus collective rights, Orthodoxy being perceived as to supporting only communal or cultural rights. Now we pass to the second part of my presentation, which is dealing with the topic individual, subject, and social dimension of Christianity. It is a common practice for Orthodox theologians, when they have to speak on the political or social engagement of the church, to appeal to the communal nature of it. This characteristic stance is probably related to the fact that religion in traditional societies has always been a supra-individual, interpersonal, communal, collective, and social phenomenon. Orthodoxy in particular entails a profoundly social dimension, since its identity, its very being, is identified with the notion of body and communion, with the eschatological and Eucharistic community of the faithful. As Father George Florovsky characteristically remarks, following on this point the ancient patristic tradition, and here I quote Florovsky, Christianity from the beginning existed as a corporate reality, as a community. To be Christian meant just to belong to the community. Nobody could be Christian by himself as an isolated individual, but only together with the brethren, in a togetherness with them. Unus Christianus, nullus Christianus. That means one Christian, no Christian. Personal conviction or even a rule of life still do not make one a Christian. Christian existence presumes and implies an incorporation, a membership in the community. This must be qualified at once in the apostolic community. End of the quotation. It was precisely this consciousness of charismatic co-belonging, the social, communal, and corporate character of Christian existence, which was indicated by the choice of the Greek political term ecclesia, a term already used in the Septuagint Old Testament text to translate the Hebrew kahal, as the word by which the first Christians defined their own identity. It is obvious from the foregoing that in this perspective the church is not a private, but rather a social or public matter, and upon first reading, this seems incompatible with the fundamental agenda and priorities of modernity. This alleged incompatibility is the cornerstone shaping the stereotypically negative view toward religion by those intellectuals who declare themselves faithful to the principles of modernity. That, in turn, provokes the defensive reflexes of Orthodox theologians and intellectuals for such an individualistic and private version of faith and religion as enshrined by modernity is not only a challenge to the social character of the Church, but also runs directly counter to the priorities and presuppositions of the theology of the person, of the relational ontology of personhood. The latter, which makes no sense apart from the questions raised by modernity, represents perhaps the most original and bold synthesis of modern Orthodox theology. Originating in Russian religious philosophy and emigre theology, especially as represented by Berdyaev, Bulgakov, and Losky, the theology of personhood culminates in the thought of the contemporary Greek theologians Christos Gianaras and Metropolitan of Pergamon Georgios Youlas, placing the answers given by Greek patristic theology into a fruitful dialogue focusing on the ontological question with the exploits of contemporary Western European philosophy. Concurrently, it makes the notion of the person, in which individuality is joined with sociality, into a basic ontological and theological category. In this context, we may make the following brief observations in relation to our topic. First, it is commonly accepted by all Orthodox theologians of all trends and schools, of all sensitivities and tendencies, that the Orthodox Church is preeminently communal, grounded in a Trinitarian conception of God. This is grounded in a Trinitarian conception of God. But does subscribing to this classic Orthodox communal understanding of the Church founded in Trinitarian theology also or necessary means to subscribe to the many stereotypes that are usually attributed to this communal understanding and which are holding as granted the radical opposition and incompatibility between individual and communal? Second remark. This connection and positive consideration between communal and individual, orthodoxy and enlightenment, and therefore between the Orthodox tradition and the theology of personhood and human rights, is clearly supported by Father John McGaikin. Unlike Yanaras and other Orthodox intellectuals who introduced and implemented a radical distinction and dichotomy between the above-mentioned elements, McGaikin considers that there is a direct, and I quote McGaikin, a direct link between earlier theological principles articulated by the Church and the Enlightenment theories that succeeded them, end of the quotation. This pro-European understanding of the spiritual and cultural heritage of Byzantium, far from any defensive and identity-based consideration, allows him even to see the connection rather than the disconnection between Byzantium and the West, as well as the emergence in the Eastern Christian civilization, especially in the canon law, of the idea of the individual and of the subject, and the warning signs of human rights. In the words of Father McGaikin himself, and I quote McGaikin here, manifest on every page a code of governance that protects, defends, and orders the Orthodox Christian community. These canons are regarded by all the Orthodox as a fundamental part of what is called the holy tradition of the Church. This development and flourishing of canon law in the East is a major rebuttal of the idea that Orthodoxy is not concerned with the rights of the individual, or that Orthodoxy can hardly conceive of the concept of the individual as such, only the collective. It is equally a defense of the fundamental Orthodox understanding that rights of persons cannot be separated from duties and responsibilities. End of the quotation. Third point. Furthermore, the characteristic of defining oneself in individual rather than communal terms is usually connected with the rise of the subject and of individuality, which has taken place par excellence during modern times and is hence regarded as an integral part of modernity. Indeed, one of the most significant upheavals, if not the most significant, that came with modernity was the emergence of the subject and the individual. For perhaps the first time in history, the individual acquires value and existence in his or her own right and his or her own autonomy. For the first time, the individual acquires such significance and importance that he is placed above the community and the organized group, above the ties and institutions of his or her culture or heritage. How alien are the above characteristics to the appearance and structure of primitive Christianity, no less than to the radical innovation it promised and to a degree effected in the framework of ecclesial communities. That is, for example, to the desacralization of Caesar and civil authority, the release of the human being from religious subordination and submission to the city, the state, or the sacralized civil authority, and biological subordination to the tribe, the patriarchal family, the clan, and the family group, to the new emphasis given by the gospel on the unrepeatable uniqueness and value of the human person, etc., etc. What else was ultimately the early Christian struggle for the right to conversion, if not the right of individuals to free themselves from their from their ancestors' religious beliefs or from their community tradition as prerequisites for adopting Christian faith? And what else is nowadays the struggle of many Christians living in Muslim countries who in a large majority are supporting human rights and the secular character of the state? So what else is the struggle of many Christians living in Muslim countries that seek to abolish the laws on blasphemy? And the laws of blasphemy is laws imposing the death penalty for every Muslim who would convert to another religion, including Christianity. If not the right of autonomous selves seeking to be free to decide their individual trajectory, which is different or even contrary to their tradition or community. Fourth point. Much support to my argument could be provided from the analysis of the phenomenon of spiritual autobiography, as it is exemplified by Augustine in the Latin West, but especially by Gregory of Nazianzus in the Greek East. I skip the presentation of Augustine because I consider it as well known, and I go directly to St. Gregory of Nazianzus. It is less known that elements of the question of subjectivity and individuality are to be found also in the autobiographical poems of Gregory of Nazianzus, who was earlier than Augustine, principally in his long autobiographical poem on his own life, which is contained in the historical poems, book 11. This Cappadocian father, after and perhaps because of his resignation from the throne of Constantinople in 381, he converses with himself and addresses himself to God, seeking consolation and peace. But he also dares to speak in the first person about his life and recount his life story in strict chronological order, from his childhood and his studies to his service as bishop and archbishop, not omitting even the most inward and personal feelings connected with the inner conflicts and contradictions that he experienced, his sorrows and disappointments, his mental pain and his complaints about friends and colleagues. In addition, he does not hesitate to castigate the attitude of the clergy of his day in terms that today would probably be described as anti-clerical. Gregory's autobiographical writing may not possess to the full the characteristics that would make him a precursor of modern literary writing or of self-aware modern man. Yet, the case of Gregory cannot easily be ignored, nor is it without importance for the questions discussed in this paper, particularly as regards the way in which questions of subjectivity and individuality fit into Orthodox theology. So while in Orthodox theological circles there is usually an emphasis on the decisive contribution of Greek patristic thought to the theology and ontology of the personhood, it is often forgotten or overlooked how much Christianity, Western and Eastern, has contributed to the emergence of the subject and its emancipation from the bonds of the city or state, the group, tribe, family, etc., etc., as envisaged inter alia in the phenomenon of spiritual autobiography. Fifth and last point, it may be that the emergence of the germ of spiritual autobiography during the first Christian centuries is inherently bound up with the dimension of inwardness and cultivation of the inner man, of the digging within oneself, etc., etc., which the Christian calling and message introduce. Indeed, here it is worth noting that the personal reception and acceptance of the gospel message, and most certainly one's entry into the church body, cannot be understood on the basis of collectives. Such as a people, nation, language, culture, etc., etc., but only on the basis of an absolutely personal act, free from any sort of biological, cultural, or ethnic determinism. Thus, the radically new element introduced by the ecclesial way of life is the personal calling addressed to us by God through Jesus Christ, a call to evangelization, to an encounter and relationship with Him, as well as the response to this call, which is equally personal. Hence, God's calling and revelation address the person, but at the same time, they also create a community. Christ's message is foundational for the person as well as for the community of the faithful. It is probably unnecessary to emphasize that personal does not mean simply individual, but nor does it mean collective. That personal calling and the response to that calling do not establish either individualism or collectivism, but the ecclesial communion of persons, the communion of saints. In this manner, the New Testament transcends the Old Testament pattern where God's calling and His agreement, covenant, with His people Israel, while not ignoring the personal element, could not be understood apart from the notion of the nation or the peculiar people, apart from the relationship with the land of the fathers. The New Testament seems to ignore this perspective. We may take a few examples from the Gospels and Acts, such as the calling of the 12, followed by a similar invitation addressed by Jesus to others, Paul's conversion on the road to Damascus, the parable of the Good Samaritan, Jesus' encounters with Zacchaeus, the pagan Canaanite woman, the Roman centurion, or even the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well. These are absolutely personal events and choices not mediated by any form of corporate entities or communities, by religious, ethnic, linguistic, cultural, or class collectives. And furthermore, these personal choices very often run counter to or against the specific communities that people belong to, just as they violate the framework and boundaries laid down by those communities. Interestingly, however, such acts of autonomy do not lead to a private religiosity or an individual version of faith and salvation. And the example of Archbishop Iacobos I use is a very good example of a Christian, of a theologian, of a pastor, of a hierarch going against his own community in order to be faithful to the Christian message. And some words of conclusion, I will skip some paragraphs, just a few words. Have attempted then to point out and highlight, albeit in an incomplete and unsystematic way, some scattered pieces of evidence for an affirmation of the subject and even of the individual personal element on the part of the Orthodox tradition. This is precisely the material that, in our view, Orthodox theology is nowadays charged with the duty to study and discuss in depth. Greek American Orthodox theologian Aristotle Papanikolaou, present here, in his informed and well-argued attempt to show that this particular understanding of personhood is not inimical to the notion of human rights, is highlighting the important contribution of the theology of personhood to this end. And I quote Telly here. After centuries of neglect, Christian theologians renewed their attention to the doctrine of the Trinity in the latter half of the 20th century. This revival of interest in the Trinity was not restricted simply to an understanding of God. Perhaps for the first time in the history of Christian thought, Christian theologians were claiming that the affirmation that God is Trinity has radical implications for theological anthropology, in other words, for thinking about what it means to be human. Christian thinkers, of course, had always linked the understanding of being human to the being of God, but only the 20th century was the more explicit claim made that since God's being is persons in communion, then human personhood must be defined in terms of relationality and communion. In other words, humans are truly persons when they image the loving, perichoretic communion of the person of the Trinity. Such an understanding of personhood emerges from what constitutes the core of the Orthodox tradition, the affirmation of divine human communion, end of the quotation. We have to confess that this remarkable theology of personhood not only very often remains socially inert, especially regarding a series of issues related to aspects of the modernist phenomenon, but also to its ecclesial self-understanding. but in addition was understood as opposed to modernity and particularly to human rights. There is an urgent need to overcome this misfortunate and tragic misunderstanding. It is therefore hoped that the new generation of Orthodox theologians will be able to reinterpret and further develop a new direction in the theology of personhood, which, despite representing a radically anti-individualistic way forward for the Church, faith, life and man, nevertheless makes no sense apart from the questions raised by modernity and its overarching agenda, since in essence those are what is trying to confront. The challenge today for the theology of the person and for Orthodox theology in general, after the first bold and very significant steps taken in the 70s and 80s, is to take up the anthropological consequence of its pioneering theological formulation about person and otherness, and to link the above-mentioned theological premises with the ongoing discussion about the emergence of the subject and its significance for the formation of modernity and late or post-modernity and the autonomous self, insofar as the theology of the personhood unites the individual and the social and communal, it may further contribute to the achievement of the sought synthesis of Orthodoxy with modernity and postmodernity, and to the correction of the excesses of both individualism and communitarianism. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Pantelis. I was very pleased that you placed a great deal of emphasis on the theology of human personhood in modern Orthodox thought. Personally, I consider that this is one of the golden threads of modern Orthodoxy, the theology of the human person, which one can trace very effectively from Vladimir Soloviev to Nicholas Berdyaev, to Sergius Bulgakov, and from them to Vladimir Lossky, although Lossky does not acknowledge his predecessors, but it is quite clear that he got it from the older generation of Russian theologians, and from there to the Greek theologians, Christos Yanaras, John Zizioulas, and I think our three speakers today are very much in this line of thought of continuing the golden thread of the theology of human personhood in Orthodox thought.